one of the singer's former One Direction bandmates postpones his tour dates. And after a rest day, the King and Queen get out and about for the start of their royal tour in Australia. Hey, good morning. We begin with the situation in Gaza, where dozens of people have been killed in Israeli airstrikes in the past 24 hours. The attacks took place across the strip as the Israeli military revealed new footage, which it says shows the former Hamas leader Yahya Sinwar just hours before the deadly 7th of October attacks on Israel. Well, let's take you through then the latest developments. On Saturday, a drone was fired from Lebanon at the Israeli Prime Minister's holiday home in the town of Caesarea. Neither Benjamin Netanyahu or his wife were at the house, and there were no reports of any injuries. Meanwhile, in Lebanon, two people were killed in an Israeli strike near a town north of the capital, Beirut. In central Gaza, at least 10 people, including two children, were killed in an Israeli strike on the town of Zawada. Another strike killed 11 people, all from the same family, in a refugee camp in Deir al-Bala. And in Jabalia, in northern Gaza, Israeli forces struck at least two houses, killing at least 40 people. And in the last few hours, there have been reports that dozens more have been killed in a strike on the nearby Beit Lahia. From Jerusalem, Adam Parsons reports.
In Gaza today, fear, panic, and yet more death. An Israeli airstrike hit this, the Nahalisi refugee camp in central Gaza. It's believed at least 12 members of the same extended family died here, and there were other deaths and other attacks. At the Jabalia camp, flames rolling out from the school, camps being bombarded by artillery fires. And it's not just Gaza that Israel has targeted. This is Junior, on the edge of Beirut, two killed here as Israel continued its assault on its northern neighbor.
We could hear the sound of the drone. I was 3 minutes away from the strike. When I got here, it struck. There were two people, a man and his wife, who were dead. Their body parts were everywhere, all the way to the police point there.
This is not one-way traffic. Israel says around 55 projectiles were fired into its northern town from Lebanon. Nobody was reported injured, but a drone did land near this, a house owned by the Israeli Prime Minister, Benjamin Netanyahu. There was no damage, and he seemed untroubled.
We're going to win this war.
So will something deter you?
No.
And all this in the wake of the death of the Hamas leader, Yahya Sinwar, killed by Israeli forces. The Israeli military has now released footage of Sinwar and his family moving into a tunnel just before October 7th, the day of the attacks that he masterminded and which were the catalyst for all that has followed.
There were no hostages with Sinwar when he was eliminated. Killing Sinwar is the result of a year of operational and intelligence efforts to bring him and other Hamas leaders justice. Sinwar has been eliminated, but our mission is not over. We will not rest until we bring all our hostages home by any means possible.
Ali Khamenei, Iran's supreme leader, praised Sinwar as a shining face of resistance and declared that Hamas is alive and will remain alive. Khamenei doesn't just mourn Sinwar. He watches these fresh attacks and wonders when and how Israel will launch its missiles in Iran's direction. That attack is sure inevitable. Adam Parsons, Sky News, Jerusalem.
And Adam, have the very latest for us now from Jerusalem.
I think they tried to do what they did in the first place. When they killed Yahya Sinwar, there were many here who thought that it was the crowning achievement of a year of effort. And they put out that footage that showed him in a room, and the Israelis felt that it cast him as a pitiful figure, trying to stick at a drone and dying on his own. But across much of this region, perhaps around the world, it was interpreted in a very different way. It was seen as a man dressed in fatigues, wearing a Palestinian scarf, who, although terribly injured, around that act of sheer defiance. I think the Israelis are aware that the narrative they wanted was not the narrative they've got. So they have now put out this footage, which they think demeans Yahya Sinwar much more. It shows him in the run-up to October 7th, the attack that he orchestrated, as they would have it, hiding away in a tunnel with his wife, with his children, rather than being out with his soldiers. The IDF spokesperson, Adem Hagari, making a point of saying that when Sinwar was killed, it was the first time that he had engaged with Israeli soldiers during this campaign. So they are trying to take away some of the luster, trying to stop this man being portrayed as a heroic martyr, despite the rhetoric that we have heard, of course, from Hamas, but also from Iran, from Yemen, and from many Palestinian supporters around the world.
Adam Parsonsdale, the latest from Jerusalem. Elsewhere, Team GB Olympic champion for Chris Boyd has revealed that his cancer is terminal. Speaking to Sunday Times, he says he's been told he has between 2 and 4 years to live. Sky's Alice Porter.
This is a shocking and explosive interview that Sir Chris Boyd has given with The Times. He was, of course, Britain's third most decorated Olympian, but we understand that he has been diagnosed with terminal cancer and only has 2 to 4 years to live. Now, in February, he dismayed fans by revealing he had cancer, not saying what particular cancer was, but that he was undergoing chemotherapy and that he was going well. And in July, he appeared fit and healthy. He was commentating for the BBC at the Paris Olympics, but clearly what was going on behind closed doors was very different, because it appears Sir Chris Hoy knew about his terminal condition for over a year, and he's now written a memoir about his experience. He's opened up about how he had a diagnosis of cancer in the first place. He thought he'd sort of strained his shoulder, his shoulder was sore, he went for a scan, and it was then revealed that he had a tumour on his shoulder. 2 days later, a second scan found primary cancer in his prostate, which had metastasized in his bones. There were tumors in his shoulder, pelvis, hip, spine, and rib. The doctor told him it was incurable with only 2 to 4 years to live. So just devastating news. He's only 48 years old. He's married with 2 young children. And clearly, this is going to be shocking to so many fans that this is someone who is incredibly fit, supposedly a very healthy person who could be so cruelly impacted by cancer and just so quickly. And he's really been very candid in this interview with The Times, really opened up about how brutal he found his experience of chemotherapy, and actually at one point had a very violent allergic reaction to it. He also has opened up about his family and about the fact that his wife, during this time of having this very difficult chemotherapy, his wife has also been diagnosed with multiple sclerosis. It's an incredibly moving interview to read. He's trying to be very positive, very upbeat about the situation the family find themselves in, and it's that upbeat, positive attitude that he brought to cycling that he is really very much trying to bring in to his cancer diagnosis, and hoping to raise awareness about cancer. But this will no doubt be incredibly upsetting news for fans, with the news that Sir Chris Hoy has got terminal cancer with only 2 to 4 years to live.
The father of 3 years old who died in the Channel on Thursday night has told Sky News.